have I in heaven but you? Whom have I in heaven? Whom have I in heaven but you? Whom have I in heaven?
I'm Come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord, our God and our Savior. Come, let us worship and bow down. Lord, we kneel before you, Lord, our God, our Maker. Oh, we come and worship and bow down before you, Jesus. Before you, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Come, let us worship. Come, let us worship and bow down. For Jesus Christ, our Lord. Come, let us worship and bow down before the Lord God, our Savior. We worship you, Jesus. We worship you, Lord Jesus. We worship you, Lord Jesus. We worship you, Lord Jesus. Holy Spirit, glorify. Holy Spirit, glorify. Holy Spirit, magnify. Holy Spirit, magnify the name of Jesus. Holy Spirit, glorify. Holy Spirit, glorify. Holy Spirit, magnify. Holy Spirit, magnify the name of Jesus. We worship you, Lord. We worship you, Lord. Jesus Christ, the Savior of my life. bow and worship you. We bow and worship you. Come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel. Let us kneel before the Lord our God, our Savior. Jesus. Jesus. Jesus Christ. Among those who will believe, among those who will believe, be glorified, be magnified. Through signs and wonders now, through signs and wonders now. In the midst of these praises, in the midst of these praises, Lord, be glorified, be glorified, be magnified. In the midst of your church, in the midst of your church, oh God, be glorified, be magnified. In the midst of your people, in the midst of your people now, be glorified, be magnified. With signs and wonders, with signs and wonders now, be glorified, be magnified. By the power of the Holy Ghost, by the power of the Holy Ghost, we worship. We worship only you, Jesus. Lord, we worship you, Jesus. Lord Jesus. Thank you.
patara, si picando la pie, pie patoka mokta. Ma pekiti patula mokrapatus.
Holy Spirit, come now, glorify the one who's crucified. Oh, Holy Spirit, come and glorify the resurrected Christ. Oh, Holy Spirit, come and glorify the one who ascended up on high. Holy Spirit, glorify with the fire and the word. Holy Spirit, glorify with signs and wonders now. Holy Spirit, glorify Jesus through me.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Ekato isipando bangleos bayan. Beyond all expressions of men, beyond all that we know or think or ask, O God, speak by the Spirit. Father, in these last days, in this time, O God, we pray in Jesus' name that there will be those who will walk in the authority that you've given. Lord, we pray, Father, O Lord of harvest, that by your signs and wonders and miracles, Lord, those who have profaned and blasphemed your name, those who've drawn back or made you less than what you are, O God, that in your love demonstrate this wonderful greatness of your power, this mighty working, this mighty love of your Spirit through us now. May everyone understand and come to know, God, that you supremely reign right now. Exalted high above all things, the Holy Spirit witnesses. Hallelujah. He testifies of this great thing that God has done for us. Redemption song, let everyone sing. By the Holy Ghost and power. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The tongues and interpretation of tongues with prophecy and revelation, with the words of knowledge and wisdom, with all the working of your power, O God, the working of miracles and gifts of healing. With this gift of faith now in operation, oh, the discerning of spirits, the revelation, the vision, the things, oh God, that you have given, this wonderful, glorious provision to prove that heaven's here, that the door's been opened, that the outpouring has taken place. The Spirit of the living God has poured out upon all flesh, upon the entirety of the human race. That no one needs to be left out. That this is that which God has spoken of. Each person stepping in right now to take hold of his great love. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let the rivers flow. Let the wellspring spring. That the whole world may begin to know God Almighty's done a work in this hour by his only begotten Son. Father, we praise you. Hallelujah. Lord, we praise you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We praise you. And let the praises never cease. Let all who love his salvation say, continually God be glorified. Let all who love his salvation say, the Lord be magnified. Let all who love your salvation say, oh, great is the Lord. Let all who love his salvation say, he's done great things for me. Hallelujah.
When they
sings my soul. Oh, this sings my soul. Oh, this sings my soul. Oh, this sings my soul. Oh, you are ever faithful. You are always sure. A helper to the helpless. A strength to the secure. Lord, you are.
life, his joy, his peace, his life, his joy, his peace, his life, his life, his joy, his peace, his life, his life, his joy, his peace, his life, his life, his joy, his peace, his love. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Come on. Ah, mighty God. Hallelujah. Listen, we don't want to stop worshiping. We just thought we'd take a break and talk to you just a little bit. We just let your hands towards heaven. You know, the nice thing about obeying God is you get to experience heaven. The nice thing about living God's way and being conformed to His way is that you get to benefit from all spiritual blessings in the heavenly realm. So right now, in the name of Jesus, I don't care who you are, where you're from, what you've been, what you've done, doesn't matter. Whether you've won 6 million people to Jesus or haven't reached one, doesn't matter. Doesn't matter. Whether you've lived in every way perfectly pleasing unto God or you just miserably failed right, left, and center, you get to come by the blood of Jesus Christ right now. You get to draw near unto the throne of grace. Be found holy and acceptable to a living God that's going to judge you one day. And I pray today, at this moment, you'll let your judgment be in Christ Jesus, who bore your sins on a tree that we call Calvary, on a hill in a little town called Jerusalem, in a little nation called Israel. 2,000 years ago, but the power and the authority and the glory of it is still and in fact greater than it was on that day because of the increase of His kingdom and of His peace. Increase, very important word. The increase of His kingdom and of His peace, there should be no end. So that means it's greater and more effective and more powerful, hallelujah, hallelujah, today than it was yesterday or 2,000 years ago, and it's going to be even more powerful, more effective tomorrow. And listen, if you want healing for your body, then you've got to learn how to stand up and move in faith when you're sick. Because people never press in for what God has. They have other alternatives. Go with me into the third world countries and you'll discover people who don't have alternatives and they only can trust in God. Healing comes easy for them. And it's not because God has preferences and He wants to heal third world people more than He wants to heal Europeans and Americans. It's just they don't have any alternatives. You know, we go to teach people how not to have alternatives in every dimension of their life, spiritually, physically, materially, financially, in every way. And then people think, well, we just radical. Freaks, something. No, we're pressing in to take hold of what God has said, what He's given. It's wonderful when you obey God, you get to flow in the gifts of the Spirit. It is amazing to stand before someone who's blind and say, see. In Jesus' name, I command you to see, and their eyes open. It's amazing. I mean, I pray that every one of God's people would do that because you just can't get over it. And you know you didn't do it. It just all of a sudden it becomes proof of how close God is to you. If there would be somebody who believed that God's word is not fictional, it's not hyperboles, it's not something that belonged to a generation that is dead and gone, but His word is living, it's powerful, that He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. That His word is provable, and if it can't be proven, then it's false. If it's not reproducible, then it's not worth following. But God's word, I tell you, is forever living. It's spirit and it's life. Hallelujah. It's unchanging. All flesh and all the ideologies and philosophies of men, they will pass away. But the word of God will endure forever. All flesh is grass, and all the glory of men is the flower of the field. It looks good for a little while. I mean, you can just rejoice in your lawn for a little while. You can think it's just a couple of days. It looks good. But no sooner does the heat come, huh? And it withers away, and it's past, and it's gone. But God's word and his promise and his love for you and me, it endures forever. But you know what? You gotta be willing to take hold of God's love for you. You gotta take hold of what he says in his word. Otherwise, you'll never truly get to experience it. You can be seated. Father, we love you. We never want to stop worshiping you. Never want to stop praising you. Never want to stop delighting in you. Father, we pray in the name of Jesus that in America there would arise so many people who would take hold of your life and of your ministry. Just be such a huge army of people. There's a huge number of people in the United States of America right now that are sitting in churches right at this moment. Wouldn't it be amazing if everybody was willing to take hold of the life of Jesus and the ministry of Jesus? Jesus said, I am, John 11:34, I believe it is. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and I am the life. If any man believes, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And you think about the life of God. Let's just consider for a few moments that when there's the presence and the life of God given free course, that there is no death. You know, John said in his epistle, he said, we know that we've passed from death unto life because we love the brethren. There's this outworking of the very presence of the living God. We love God's people. That's to start with. We love God's people. I know some folks who say that, you know, they just love the world like God loves the world, and they're going and doing, you know, their thing that they're doing, but they don't love the people of God. They don't love the church. Why? Because somebody offended them. You know what? If you just had that response to every single human being, you know what I'm saying? You would have no friends and be around no persons. And God teaches us how to love people in the midst of offenses. Huh?
Yes.
I mean, God, listen, come on, people. The neuroscientist, the neurosurgeon doesn't expect you to understand what he's going to operate on your pineal gland by innervating your cranium, you know, your brain through your nose instead of entering through the occipital part of your brain. He just expects you to trust him, and you're not really interested if you're really in need. Because you got something there that needs to be fixed. Are you understanding?
Yes.
Well, listen, we got to figure God's got to tell us every little detail. Huh? Because his understanding and his knowledge surpasses the understanding and the knowledge of men. I mean, you could get pretty impressed and, you know, or depressed about the intellect of men and all the things that men have discovered and come to know. We get to benefit by it today in some very unique ways. But just think about the knowledge of the Lord. That when he says to us, he says his wisdom, he says the wisdom of men is foolishness to him. Just imagine what kind of knowledge and understanding Papa would like to get to us. He wants to give us the wisdom and understanding how to not live in offense anymore. How to have people get all upset with us and say all kinds of bad things to us, and it's meaningless. And all we can feel is a great compassion and a great love for them. Because we're surrounded by heaven. Heaven is love. Heaven is joy. Heaven is peace. I'm living in heaven today because Jesus is heaven. And Jesus is mine. So I'm living in heaven today. That's A.B. Simpson, Presbyterian preacher, who stepped into the anointing of the Holy Ghost in early 1880s, started a Christian Missionary Alliance Church. It was much different then. He's walking on, you know, the shores of the East Coast asking God for the fire of the Holy Ghost. Huh? Had a heart condition. He had a heart disease. And he read how that Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever, and heard a couple of people preach about the anointing of the Holy Ghost that not only brought to us the revelation of who Jesus is, but brought the power and the grace and the goodness of God to every dimension of our need. And he grabbed a hold of that and he said, okay, Jesus, I believe that you're not only the Savior, but also the healer. That Presbyterian preacher that day got touched by the power of God. He writes that the next morning, some other men of God asked him to go on a hike with them up the mountain. Well, that's just hills there, you know, up in Maine. It's just hills compared to mountains. They think it's mountains because they haven't been out here. You know, everywhere you go, you get a new perspective of life. That's why God wants to take us over in some realms of the Spirit so we get a new perspective of life. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. So his first thought was, no, I can't. I have a heart disease. Then he thought a second time. He said, wait a minute. Jesus is the healer. I got healed yesterday. Walking alone on the beach with him, responding to a sermon that I heard preached that I just had real problems with when it was delivered. Huh? I recognize that sometimes the word of God, it just kind of creeps up on you kind of thing. It has to get you later on. You might be upset during the meeting this morning. You might hear some things that you don't like, but if it's the word of God, it doesn't return void. Amen. It go to work on you. God, the word, hallelujah, is Christ Jesus. He's the living word, and the written word, you know, is all about him. And Father loves us so much. He pursues us. Won't let us go. My mama said, he's like a bloodhound on scent. You know, those Tennessee people know what that means. A bloodhound on scent. He's not letting up on you. Hallelujah. He's just a full chase. Somebody said they're chasing God. I say he's chasing you. I say he's on you. And he wrestles with us. He wrestles. He calls out to us like he called out to Adam. He said, Adam, where are you at? Adam disobeyed God. God made Adam a living being. The scripture says in Genesis chapter 1, Genesis chapter 2, God made Adam a living being. And Adam disobeyed God and chose rather to listen to some other news, to go with some other opinion, to go with some other word. And Father came looking for him. He said, Adam, where are you at? And, you know, some of you would think like, you know, somehow the Lord didn't know. The Lord knew. He knew what was going on. He just wanted, he was going to listen to man. He wanted to hear man confession. What are you doing? What are you doing? Huh? He came crying out to God, crying out to Adam. God came crying out to Adam in his love and his mercy, in pursuit of him. God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten son in pursuit of us. Why go halfway? Why go just part of the way with God? Why believe and edit the word of God and only believe that somehow the resurrection and life is going to speak to your dust and ash in a grave, and that you're going to be raised up, and you can't believe him for a toothache? You can't trust him with your financial affairs. Come on, people, we need some brainwashing. Amen. It's the washing of the water of the word. I mean, it's a mind scrubbing. Hallelujah. And God wants to teach us to think different. You know, you go to Ivy League schools now, and one of the biggest things that they're saying, Ivy League schools and graduate school, is you got to learn how to think different. You got to unlearn what you know so that you can begin to expand the possibilities. That's true in the realms of the Spirit. We come with all these biased and all these preconceived ideas, and then we got a bunch of people who's in the same, you know, prison and in the same, you know, monkey trap. You know that, what a monkey trap is, right? Monkey sticks his hand into the cage and grabs a hold of whatever was in there, and he won't let go. It's easy to escape, just let go. But he's got this reflex that will not let go. I got food in my hand, and I will not let it go until it is in my mouth. That's the monkey trap. People just trap by things that would be so easily escaped from if they would just listen to reason. Huh? I know we like to think of ourselves as more brilliant than a little chimpanzee, but sometimes we gotta, come on. Yes, it's true. Yes, it's true. Vegetation doesn't think much, right? Huh? I've got a little puppy. He thinks a whole lot more. He's learning, where's the ball? He started to get it. Where's the ball? He started to get it. But then I wouldn't want to be stuck in that realm. And you get a little bit low above of that, you got a bunch of humans running around so brilliant. They're thinking. And Father says, I want to elevate you over into another place. I want to show you how to think in such a way that you walk upon the water. I want to teach you how to live forever. I want to show you that I am the life. I'll give you my life. I'll show you how to function life. People think that Jesus is the Savior. Just come and give people, everybody, just give everybody an opportunity to come to heaven, be in heaven, no matter who you are and what you've done, that you can die and go to heaven. No, that's not what Jesus came. Jesus came to change your heart, to change your perspective of life, to give you his life so that you'll have his nature, his character, his ways, his disposition. If you think, well, loving God's going to not allow anybody to go to hell. Listen, you don't understand. If people want to continue on in darkness and sin and hell, if God was to allow them to come into heaven, heaven would be quickly changed to hell. Well, there's no difference. We got to learn how to do what's right. God, the Holy Ghost, come teach us how to do what's right. And then in the midst of teaching us how to do what's right, he wants to lavish upon us all his blessings and all of his love and all of his mercy and all of his care, and then show us how to treat other people the same way.
Amen.
Is that amazing or what? But we got to think different. We have to be willing to think different. We got to be willing to take a hold of what God has provided for us within the realms of his word, which we would then define as, listen and understand, people think that, well, I want to have this spiritual mind. That's good. I want to have this mind of Christ. I want to have the mind of God, the thoughts of God. I want to understand how to move over there in that realm where I think like God. Well, it's simple. Start believing the word of God. And you got to, believing the word of God isn't just hearing it. It's not just saying it. That's a start. That's a start. There's a lot of people just need to do that. They need to hear it and they need to say it. But it's doing it. It's doing it. And sometimes it's difficult. Sometimes you got a lot of stuff up against you because Father's going to say, listen, are you willing to go someplace with me? I'm not going to tell you where we're going to go. You just got to follow me. Well, what kind of sensibility is, what kind of sense is that? Because then what we'll do is we'll backslide and go over to start thinking about what God, what men said. God's given us all wisdom so we can figure it all out or whatever, you know. They didn't say that. He said to Abraham, he said, listen, I'm going to take you someplace, but I'm not going to tell you where we're going to go. You got to follow me. And by the way, you got to leave your job. You got to leave your family. You got to leave your house. You got to leave your comforts, your protection. And that's much different. That is much different than you just basically doing, going from California, you know, to wherever. Minnesota. Because now you're going to leave, because you're going to leave the place of your high walls and your defense, and you're going to go out and you're going to become vulnerable to people who are very territorial, and they are going to kill you because you pose a threat by being there. And now the Lord's going to say, I want you to follow me. I want you to leave everything behind and go with me. What is he trying to say here? What is he doing with this interaction with Abraham? He's looking for somebody to trust him. Because a relationship that God wants to have with us is a relationship where we really truly believe that he is God. And if he's God, then there's nothing that can hurt us, nothing that can harm us, nothing that can threaten us, nothing that can overwhelm us, nothing that can stop us. I mean, he's God, he's sovereign. Who can defy the will of God? And he's looking for some people who would believe him. And reality of it is that belief is only tried when things are difficult for you. Your love is only tried when people hate you. That's why the context of the scripture is, here's how to discern love. 1 John 3:16. Here's how we discern love. Because we see that God so loved us that Jesus Christ laid his life down for us. And this is how we're supposed to now treat everyone else. And that's just, I just took a little bit of license with that verse of scripture just to really try to, haven't changed it. And if you want to look at it, go ahead. Just turn to 1 John 3:16. Just look at it. I just changed it just a little bit just to make it more specific for you and your situation. Here's how we discern. Because people got different ideas about love. Well, I hear this all the time. Well, God doesn't expect me to. Oh, yes, he does. Oh, God doesn't expect me to. Yes, he does. If it has to do with trust, if it has to do with believing him, when everything else in the logic and the rational thinking says, no, don't do that. After all, God created doctors to help us. I didn't read that verse of scripture. I didn't read that. I read rather how he bore our sins in his own body on the tree, that we being dead to sin might live unto righteousness, by whose wound we were healed. I've read over and again about how Christ Jesus, he's the healer, how that he gave us authority over all sickness and disease. But now you're at the crossroads and you've got medical insurance instead of Jesus assurance. And then people don't like this, because then I'm now putting them in this situation where they feel a little bit uncomfortable about their relationship. I don't want you to feel uncomfortable about your relationship. I just want you to enter into deeper realms of it.
Amen.
Huh? Yes. And you know, somebody said, are you telling me we can't go to the doctors? We wouldn't be right? No, I'm not going to tell you that. Now, the generation before would have told you that, and they had great signs and wonders and miracles. Let me just say this. The generation before would have told you that. I think we've gone so far that we hardly could even bear that. If you'd have talked to Wigglesworth, if you'd have talked to John G. Lake, if you'd have talked to people who had such a demonstration of the power of God, they would have told you that. And it was part and parcel to the demonstration of their radical faith. But what I recognize and what I know is that people have been so culturalized by modern society that there's no way that they're going to get there by some kind of legislative dictate, if you would. You got to step into a relationship in this. Because if you try to have my faith, which is out of my relationship with the Lord, then it ain't going to work for you. It's not going to work for you. The Lord wants you to walk with him. He wants to teach you how to walk with him. He wants to teach you how to believe him. Now, I tell you, my children, I train my children up how to move in faith and how to move in the gifts of the Spirit, and, you know, they're my responsibility. So they got to live off of my faith. I'm the same way with my grandchildren. I'm not going to stand by and watch them be molded and shaped by a culture that is anti-God, that is anti-Christ, that I can prove. This isn't just some kind of just radical disposition with no evidence to back up or support my statement. I can prove unequivocally that what I've just said is an absolute. It's not just a fact. It's not just a possibility, but it's an absolute. Because God's word has called us to come out from culture. It's called us to come out from society. It's called us to come out from the world so that we can be trained and taught by him. And that's what he was doing with Abraham. See, Adam probably failed in the first sight of the first, week, maybe even couple of days. Truly, it wasn't long. It wasn't not long. Because the Lord, and somebody said, how do you know that? Well, the Lord blessed him and said, be fruitful and multiply. And out of my own personal experience, I know what it means, you know, to be fruitful and multiply once you get married. Amen. Because it was in short order, and Joshua came. Praise God. Hallelujah. Huh? And I'm just telling you right now, there was nothing hindering the blessing of God in Adam and Eve's life. Huh? But they hadn't even gotten that far yet. And it was because they didn't know what they were doing. So I just help you with that. It was very clear. God brought all the animals to him and he named them. And Father blessed everything and told it to be fruitful and multiply. And he put that instinct in them. Are they listening to me?
Yes.
The enemy overthrew that quickly. I don't want to give you too much information, but it's helpful. The enemy overthrew that very quickly. Just simply because man was not willing to trust God and believe God in the face of an alternative and another suggestion, another option. And there's no difference between you and I. There's God's word. It's plain and simple. He doesn't go into an elaborate, you know, explanation. You know, it's like with the rich man. And the rich man comes and says, good master, what must I do to inherit eternal life? Jesus laid it on him. He says, well, what did Moses say? And he laid it out. He laid it out. You should love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all of your soul, with all of your mind, with all of your being. You should love your neighbor as yourself. All these things have I done since my youth. And the Lord says, responds to him, and recognizes that he has done this faithfully. He says, now there's one thing that you lack. Uh-oh. He's going to now encroach upon that which is most important to us, which we cannot possibly rationalize why he would ask these things of us. Go sell all that you have and give it to the poor and come follow me. Jesus didn't tell a lot of people at the time to come and follow him in that sense, to be a disciple, because the Lord kept it small numbers at the time. Now everybody gets to come. He's got his arms wide open and says, come follow me. And the man went away very sad that day. The rich man went away very sad. Now, later on, right after he left, the Lord begins to tell the disciples, because they're asking him questions, says, Lord, what about us? We've left everything. He says, listen, guys, settle down. There's nobody who's forsaken everything to come and follow me, except they're going to receive 100-fold in this life. And after they're dead, after in the next life, they're going to receive eternal life. Now, he could have given that great explanation to the rich man, but he didn't. We just want to be convinced with our mind. God's not willing to convince our mind. He wants to touch our heart. And if we're not willing to respond to his word, because as soon as his word comes forth, we want to recline on our great experience and our great intellect and our great processes of logical thinking and rational, you know, thinking and perception. The Lord isn't going to even be involved in that. He's not going to talk about it. He wants us to trust him. Like little children, he wants you to be converted. And somebody said, well, you telling me I got to check my brain? Listen, it ain't that much anyways to check. You're not giving up much. You're not risking much, okay? It's not like, you know, like somebody getting ready to gamble, throw the dice for $1 million or something. You're not risking much, you know? You throw in the die for $1 million and then you're going to get a trillion. No, it's far, far different than that. All you're going to do is risk whatever little ideas that you have begun to be, you know, have formed in your life and shaped in your life and relied on, and for most people it hasn't worked very well, right? That other men have come up with in exchange for what God says. And he says, I'll prove myself to you. I'll prove myself to you. Believe me. I'll prove myself to you. I want you to exchange your life for mine. I'll get you, you give me your life and let it be put to death on the tree where I died. And I'll give you my life. That's life, and that's resurrection life. That's the life that has come into us. This life that now produces this kind of love, to where that in the opposition, as I was saying here in 1 John chapter 3, I'll come back to what I was saying here in just a minute. I like to have 3-4 different subjects going at the same time. It's just the way I am. Can't help it. It's the way God made me in the Holy Ghost. Verse 16 says, hereby perceive we the love of God, because he laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for the brethren. Well, that's real easy, so long as everybody's high-fiving and hugging and everybody likes everybody and it's fresh and it's new and, you know, you've just known each other for a week. But how about when all of a sudden the offense has come? That's when real love kicks in, because the Lord's describing to us a love that he showed when everybody hated him, spoke evil against him, said that he was not of God but was of the devil. Every foul thing, every opposing thing, every evil thing, every threatening thing, every reproving thing, every opposing thing that could possibly be thrown at him or that he could possibly even endure was the context of him laying down his life for us. And he says, this is how I want my love to be expressed through you. Listen, this life is wonderful, but the development of it and the maturation of it comes with some pretty intense oppositions. You're going to have to obey God when your mind says, and your thinking and your culture and everything about you says, no, you don't have to do this. You don't have to be somebody's doormat. You don't have to be run over top of somebody by other people. God expects you to be celebrated everywhere you go. Did you read that? Lay down your life for everybody. Hereby we receive the love of God. Lay down your life for everybody who celebrates you. It's the same way love works, the same way joy works. Joy, God allows us to develop love in a beautiful, secure, safe environment of flowing in the Holy Ghost and intimate relationship with him. That's where it gets strong. We get to develop joy in that wonderful, safe, secure environment with him. Peace But then what's going to happen is we're going to go out into the world and we're going to have tribulation. We're going to have all kinds of opposition. We're going to have everything that can come at that to try to beat that down and overthrow that. Many are the afflictions of the righteous. The good news is the Lord delivers us out of them all if we're willing to stand and trust Him, if we're willing to just have the repose, the response that He Himself demonstrated for us. Everything in your world is against this, but let me tell you this. If you'll just begin to obey God and do it His way, you're going to get to experience heaven. You're going to get to experience all the spiritual blessings that He's blessed us with in a heavenly realm. I mean, you get to live days of heaven upon the earth because you're willing to go with God instead of with your own personal opinion. You're willing to say no to sin, which is even a far much worse state than gross state. You know, let me just stop for a moment and just think about this. Men today, and unfortunately many people in church today, they get their entertainment and their thrills by watching a demon spirit destroy another human being's life. It's true. Because watching an act of sin is an activity of a demon spirit producing in a person's life destruction and despair. And there's no place that is being expressed like the realms of pornography. But it goes on and on. And so actually, society, people say society is getting better. No, it's getting worse. Culturally, spiritually, it is getting actually worse. I mean, that's far worse than watching the gladiators in an arena. And I don't want to go into all the proofs on that. I just want to just lay that out before you, because Satan creates a deception to where that sin becomes harmless and no one even begins to think about its destructive effect upon those who are doing it. God has come to bring us His life where there is no death in it. That's why John said, everyone who has Christ Jesus as the Son has life, and those who do not have Christ Jesus the Son are dead while they are lived. You do not have life. There's no life outside of Jesus. God became flesh. God became flesh, proven by the blood and the water at birth. You with me?
Yes.
At birth. There's a bunch of that. Proven by the blood and the water at birth all the way to the moment in time that blood and water flowed out of His side at Calvary. Proven by the water from the time He was baptized in the Jordan to the blood that poured forth from His body, proven to be God, made a human being, made everything like we are so that you and I could be made everything like He is within the context of spiritual life, knowing life, knowing what it means to truly be alive, a life that is does not ever cease, both in quantity as in also in quality. And who wants to live a life forever where there's nothing but hate and violence and murder and war? Everybody. It's like society has come again to a place where it's ready for war. See, society, let me just point this out to you for just a moment. Society at the end of World War II said, we don't want to go through this again. And so they formed NATO. They formed other various different alliances between nations in hopes that if everybody had common interest and common goals, that they would work together instead of fighting about it. We're not interested anymore. We're so far away from that. But then you get in the midst of bodies blown to pieces and all the devastation and all of the turmoil and upheaval and death. Huh? Suddenly, an awakening comes of how terrible it is. God, the Father, in His loving kindness and tender mercy, came to deliver us from so great a death so we could step over into His life. But people begin to become accustomed, to the things that they hold dear and that they believe in, and forsake the way of life and truth. Come on, people. God's calling you and I into a place of walking with Him. We're not going to be able to intellectualize. We look at Abraham as a model of faith, and we understand Abraham as a model of faith by being willing to go out and followed the Lord into a place where he did not know where he was going, with total abandonment to leave everything. So if we started there and we found ourselves there, you think about all the challenges that you have right now, being to some degree there, though God has never taken you to that level of a call, as it were, and responsibility. If we could just look at it, however, through the eyes of wisdom, and we can see it now, Abraham, having become heir of the world, having been made exceedingly wealthy, having been protected and provided for by God Almighty on the scale that you begin to look at by the time you get to Genesis chapter 22 and 23, suddenly we go, oh, wow, this is worth it. Look at that. Look at the end. Look at the end of the man who trusts God. Look at the end of the man who will risk his life to walk with God and serve God, who will abandon all human reasoning and all human logic to just simply walk as a child in obedience to the word of his father. That's where you're at right now. That's where you're at with relationships right now. That's where you're at right now financially, maybe. That's where you're at right now in terms of maybe disease or sickness in your body. The Lord is the healer. I am the Lord that heals you, says the Lord. I am. That's what he said. Is he a liar?
No.
If we're not going to believe God's witness, there are three that bear witness in heaven, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And they're all bearing witness of one thing, of redemption, of what God did for us when he redeemed us. Hallelujah. With the blood of the only begotten Son. Father's a witness to that. That's why the scripture says, if you don't believe what the record that God gave of his Son, you've made God a liar. What is the record that God made of his Son? Of course, you know, I'm quoting right now 1 John 5:10. And of course, if you look at the whole pericope or context, it's 1 John 5:7-10. What is the record that God gave of his Son? That in him is life. And that life is eternal life, and it's a wellspring springing up on the inside of you, producing the very nature and life and attitude and emotion and passion and all these good things that Father himself experiences when today. And we can't say that he woke up, but, you know, just today. Because he don't slumber, he never slumbers nor sleeps. He's there with us, watching over us. I pray in the name of Jesus Christ that you'll begin to experience this life. That you'll begin to experience the abundance of the life. The quality of the life. You're going to have to wait to really understand the quantity. But right now you can begin to experience the quality of it. A love so rich and so free, so passes knowledge, that it doesn't matter who offends you, who says something evil against you, what they have to say, what their criticism is. I was in a situation the other day, and a couple of preachers came to me, and the power of God touched them radically in the meeting. And one of the guys that was working to try to just give me, as it were, a compliment and tell me he'd never experienced the presence of the Lord like that, but he's just kind of hedging at it because he's telling me, well, you know, I don't want to say something that would blow your mind up or whatever, you know, that would blow your head up or whatever, make you feel too good about yourself. You know, you understand what I'm saying. Those weren't the words he used. But I said, listen, I said, don't worry about that. Just tell me what you want to tell me. I said, I have been through the school of how to take a compliment. He says, oh, yeah? He says, what's that? I said, a lifetime of persecution, and it doesn't bother me. It bothered me at first, but don't bother me now. Why? Because I'm protected. I'm protected. I'm surrounded by a glory that, no offense. And then that way I can go ahead and live in the truth. I'm not living my life to please people. I'm living my life to please him, and you live your life to please him. Everybody's going to end up being blessed. They're going to go, you can't offend the guy. Huh? He still loves you no matter what you do him. That's what Papa's teaching us. He still loves us no matter what we do to him. But we still have got to be willing to learn his ways. Otherwise, heaven's going to become hell if you get in. Mm-hmm. Hello?
Yes.
Hello?
Yes.
It's, come on. It's the badger in the kitchen. It's the bull in the living room. Come on. It's a mess. It is a mess. Papa wants to do, he's done all this thing. everything you could possibly ask, everything we could possibly think, He's come in to change our heart, give us a new heart, give us a new spirit. You say, my heart is hurting. I don't even know where to begin with God. Where you begin is you respond to His call to salvation. He said, I'll make you new. I'll take the hurt away. I'll take the pain away. I'll make you new. I'll give you a new heart. I'll give you a new spirit, because there's no way you're ever going to work your way out of your problems. There's never a way that you're going to be a solution to your own need. There's no way. There's no way out of the depths of despair and death that you've gotten yourself into. I'll make you brand new. I'll completely erase it. I'll remove it out of the way. You'll have an entirely new beginning with me. And I'll give you my own spirit to teach you how to walk with me, how to live for me, to strengthen you and empower you. But once again, it's still going to be a trust. Because we're going to, the first response may be, the first responders may not look good. A first response may be to descend yourself and immediately go, wait a minute. Holy Ghost, thank you for this wellspring of life that's on the inside of me, producing within me the love, the patience, the long-suffering, the goodness, to have compassion. I know people who have passion, great passion, but they've never really been developed in compassion. They got a great passion for God, but the compassion's not there. We just walk with the Lord, and He'll develop us in a great compassion. And when there's a great compassion, there's a great mercy. And all of a sudden, it isn't. We get all offended. Once again, we get all offended, really, because we want the world to celebrate us. The world will not celebrate you. I'm sorry to tell you. I know it just ain't right. And it is not the way the Lord defined it. Wait till you get to heaven. Everybody will celebrate you in heaven. Hallelujah. But right now, you're not going to get celebrated. But reality of it is, Father causes us to live in a relationship where that doesn't matter anymore. And so long as you've got wrong expectations and you want to be celebrated, you are going to be extremely disappointed on the level of unforgiveness and hurt. But if you just recognize, wait a minute, my celebration is another realm. I just understand why people are the way they are. And I've got a great compassion for that state. Not a rejection of them. I'm just going to hang with the dogs and the cattle and the horses. Because a lot of people had that response. I'm going out into the woods. No, we lay down our life. Love compels us. We are compelled by the love of God to get people out of their prison. That's what God did for us. That's how He commended His love towards us. He says, I'm the life and I want to fill you with my life. I'm the resurrection and I'm going to fill you with my resurrection. Because everybody's going to be raised up on that last day. There's a last day. There's two last days, actually. But you know, that's, a lot of times that's the way the scripture works. There's a last day of the resurrection of the righteous just. Then 1,000 years later, there's going to be a resurrection of those who are sinners and died in their sins and died in a state of rebellion against God. Or the wicked, as they're also called. What is the wicked? Those who won't trust God. They want to do it their own way. Oh, I thought wickedness is where you like chopped people's heads off. No. That's terrible. I can't think of anything worse. And it's happening today. How do you feel about ISIS? I have a great compassion for them. I'm not threatened by them. Who do you not like? Because CNN has created the spin, or Fox News Network, or whatever it is. It's very different when you get on the ground. You look in people's eyes. You understand what's going on. I pray today in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth that you begin to be willing to be conformed to the image of Christ Jesus by being willing to be obedient to God's word no matter how difficult it is for you. We've been with people where they come into the meeting and they immediately get healed. It was a wonderful thing. It's a wonderful thing. Immediately they get healed. I was with a woman the other day. She came in to the meeting, first meeting. Lyme's disease, totally healed. I said, how are you doing? She said, all my scars are disappearing. This is just recently. It happened a year and a half ago. Lyme disease creates scars, scarring the body. All my scars are disappearing. It's beautiful. But there's sometimes people need to sit in the meeting for a long time. Because God's got to work things out in their spirit. And I say that with every dimension. I just think healing is a great way to describe it. It's a great way to describe some of the things that God's got to deal with us a long time with the more unseen realm of our lives. But if people keep coming, if they'll keep coming to the meeting. I was in a, when we were in a meeting and hundreds of people were being healed. There were thousands and thousands of people there. Okay? Hundreds and hundreds of people are being healed. So there's this guy, I look at this guy, he's in a wheelchair. He's a Hindu. It's a Hindu country. All around him, he's seeing people that are out of wheelchairs that were come on cots running around. He's looking at me earnestly. He said, I want out of this wheelchair. He could speak English. He said, I want out of this wheelchair. I said, you got to come tomorrow night. He was disappointed. He didn't come the next night. He said, I can't come tomorrow night. I said, yeah, you, I said, you want to get out of the wheelchair, you got to come tomorrow night. And he's looking around at other people. Well, and it, here's the, our first response. Well, what about them? And the Lord's not talking to you about them. He's talking to you about you. Why am I having to go through what I'm going through? Why is this all these things happening to me? You need to start getting thankful. You need to start praising God. You need to understand he prevented you from something worse. He's trying to get a hold of you. He's trying to talk to you. You need to understand how to say, sweet trouble. Come deliver me from my problem. Come on. It's true. It's true. Well, we're blaming God for our situation. You need to start worshiping him and thanking him and believing how big he is, how wonderful he is, and never letting up on the reality that he's come to heal you as well as he's come to save you. He's come to provide for you. He's come to deliver you. He's my Savior already, but he's going to save me from anything that happens to me today. He's my Savior. He's my deliverer. He's always there saving me, delivering me, keeping me. Hallelujah. As you walk out of relationship with them, faith grows and strengthens. So as soon as the pain comes, it's got to go. As soon as the financial need is there, you're able to call the finances in. Hallelujah. You're able to speak to the rock and the water comes out. My, 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 my. When's the last time you talked to the rock and the water came out? Huh? Huh? When is the last time you had that kind of new logic, new thinking? Mind of Christ thinking. That's what the Word of God teaches us. Obeying God is how we really truly learn how to function in the Word of God, how to stand there and having done all to stand. A dear young woman, her and her husband loved the missions, or loved their ministry in Zambia. And they had come back from a short, this just recently happened, from a short, just to come back for a short stay in the United States of America to help raise support and whatnot. And she's up on a ladder and she falls back on a ladder and becomes a paraplegic. Something happened on the ladder. She got knocked out somehow. It was like a sucker punch from hell. And she landed in such a way she became a paraplegic. The doctors are there trying to test her a couple of months ago to see if there was any possibility there would ever be any life in the nervous system of her body ever again, that any of her limbs would function. And all of the monitoring and everything that they came up with as they're trying to measure this says zero. And it took a couple hours to get her all hooked up to all this equipment, and now she's unhooked, and now they're telling her there is absolutely zero possibility. There is no response from your central nervous system. She says, put me back on the machine. Put me back on the machine. And she began to cry and plead with them, because it's a huge thing for them to put her back on. Look, we've done our experiments. Put me back on there. So with her insistence, they put her back on it. The whole equipment was put back on her. She began to cry out, Lord Jesus, you hear what these doctors are saying. Lord Jesus, come help me now. Everybody's embarrassed. We're feeling all awkward. This is weird. What an emotional outburst. Bring some medication quickly. Because that's going to be their intellectual response to the situation. Suddenly the monitor's going, bing, 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 bing. Things start lining up. Huh? They got to witness somebody who will not take the answers of men or the word of men.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Her recovery has been slow, but it's recovering.
Amen.
It's recovering. Amen. All she can think of is, I want to be back in Africa, reaching the unreached. I want to be back. And somebody says, why did that happen? Would you quit trying to be so brilliant? Why do you need an explanation for everything? Why are you on a need-to-know basis? Huh? The Lord said, follow me. He said, obey me. He said, believe me. Don't believe me when it's convenient for you. Believe me. Huh? Don't believe me just when it's easy. Believe me. Don't obey me just when it's convenient for me. Obey me. Just when it's convenient for you. Obey me. Whatever situation you find yourself in. Jesus said, I am the life. Think of it. I am the life. He that believes on me, though he were dead, I am the life. I am the resurrection and the life. He that believes on me. And of course, we know that John, in the first epistle of John, really defines what it means to believe. And he puts the belief down with the proofs. And those proofs are beautiful. They're wonderful. I pray that you'll make a study of the first epistle of John, understand the proofs that are laid out there, and say, okay, Lord, I want to be what you purposed me to be. This is not some kind of terrible life where I'm missing out on the fun. This is where life begins. This is where I get to step in to everything that pertains to life and godliness. Today, if there's one piece of wisdom that I want you to get and walk out of here with, is this, that the wages of sin is death. That will give you great insight in the choices that you make. The wages of sin is death. It's still death. Somebody said, no, it's not. Well, then many things that Paul said and Jesus said makes no sense. Like, for example, Paul said it's better, and this is for somebody here right now, it's better to marry than to burn. Huh? If sin did not have a consequence, that didn't make any sense. And I can give you hundreds of more. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is the life of Jesus. It's the life of God. It's eternal life, unending life. It's a life that's got joy unspeakable and full of glory. Would you like to live that? It's like, is there anybody that you know that wouldn't want to be happy all day? Joyful? All day long? No matter what anybody's doing, you're just happy? My son Daniel showed me a great way to deal with obnoxious people on the highway. Because we all have to deal with obnoxious people on the highway. Everybody gets on the highway, turns into a devil, practically. Nice people normally, but get in behind the wheel and it's like, pfft. It's weird. Here's what he does. He smiles real big and waves at them like he knows him. And they're like, do I know that person? You can see what's going on in their head. What a beautiful way to deal with opposition. What a beautiful way to learn how to bless people when they persecute you.
Yes.
On every level. Not just on a couple of things that you understand, but on every level. To where that you're so overwhelmed by his life. You're so overwhelmed by his goodness. But you're so overwhelmed by his presence. It becomes the natural response, the first response. Father wants to develop that in us.
Yes.
Allow that to mature. Allow that to grow and be strengthened. But you and I are going to have to start yielding our members to him, saying yes with him, agreeing with him, walking and going to a place that we do not know where we're going. We do not understand why we're going there. Other than he says, I want you to trust me. Adam failed there. And God's still loving. Adam, where are you at? Where are you at, Adam? God's still calling every human being, every man, no matter who they are, he's still calling. Every person I look at, I know that the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to them. I know that the Holy Ghost has been poured out upon them because he's poured out upon all flesh. I know. I know what God said. I don't care what they say. They say they're agnostic, atheist, whatever. I know what's really going on inside. That's their facade. That's their intellectual realm. That's their intellectual defense. I know what's going on in their life. And God's word is the power to change men's hearts. And I pray in the name of Jesus, you'll go all the way, not part way. Don't just leave and go a little way down the road with him. Go all the way with him. Where Adam failed, Abraham succeeded. Abraham went all the way with God. when all through the hardships and all through the trials and all through the hard times and all through the opposing situations and circumstances. I love to tell people this. I'm getting ready to close. I just want you to hold with me for just a minute. I love to tell people this. When God told Abraham, he said, send Ishmael away. Abraham loved Ishmael. That's his firstborn son. He loved him. And Abraham had been so trained by God by this time that Abraham could have loaded up the camels with gold and great provision to take care of the boy for the rest of his life. But he sent him out with enough provision for one day, enough bread and water for one day. Why? Because he knew the Almighty God was a better provider than he himself was, and that Father was going to take great care of him, because Father had already said, I'll make mighty nations out of him. Well, I don't need to get in the way of Father's provision. People say, well, that's child abuse, that's uncaring, that's radical, that's freaky. No, that's somebody who's walked with God, knows God. God's God. Let God be God. Amen. Huh? That was just a preparation for when the Lord was going to say, take now your son, your Isaac, in whom all of your promise, and which your whole relationship with me in large part has been centered around, that I'll make your seed as the sand of the seas and as the stars of heaven, and offer him in the place that I'll show you. Listen to his response. He wasn't agonizing about it, because he'd come to know who God is. He'd come to trust Father. So he says to his servants, the boy and I are going to go over there and we're going to worship and we'll come back to you. You guys stay here. Here is faith. Here is confidence in who God is. In the most opposing and trying moment of his life, the Lord says, now, he says, hurt not the lad, hurt not your boy. For now I know that you fear me. That there's nothing that you will withhold from me. That you will trust me. That you'll recognize who I am. If we can just begin to recognize how much God loves us, what a benefactor he is, how benevolent he is, how compassionate he is, how merciful he is, how faithful he is. There's nothing that we would withhold from him. There's nothing that we would not do in obedience to our Father. Would you stand with me, please? Obey him. Take hold of him, because I'm going to tell you right now, the wages of sin is death. It's going to create destruction. It's going to create pain. I don't care how good it may look, how enticing it may be, is going to create destruction and pain and turmoil for everybody it touches. It is a plague. It is a plague of hurt and heartache and sorrow. But the gift of God is eternal life. Death is only a doorway by which you pass into forever. You hear me? It's not a fairy tale. Death is a doorway in which you pass into forever. Jesus said, I am the truth, the life, and the way. No man can come to the Father except by me. Jesus gave to us an opportunity to be freed from every power of death and every claim of sin and iniquity and every false way that took a hold of the heart of man when Adam disobeyed and walked away from God. And in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, Paul said, Adam was made a living being. The first Adam. Speaking of the first man that God created. He said, but the last Adam, speaking of the Lord Jesus Christ, is a reviving spirit. He will revive you. He will revive anyone who will call upon his name. He is the resurrection and life. He'll give you spiritual resurrection. You'll raise up unto the life that God intended men to have. And it will have the expressions of his praise and of his thanksgiving and of his joy and of his goodness and of his gladness. It will have that expression of trusting God with total abandonment. But I'm going to tell you right now that all will be challenged. It will all be tried. And you and I have been given the will to make choices. And the only right choice to make is what God describes in his word. Let me just read this to you, please, as you're standing. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 20. But now is Christ risen from the dead, and he's become the first fruits of those that sleep. For since by man came death, by man came also the resurrection from the dead. God became flesh. God became man. God, who is rich, became poor for our sake. Through his poverty, we may become so wealthy. God, who loved us so much, became like us, became the sin offering that we may be made God's righteousness, the very expression of what he intended when he formed man as image and his likeness, so that you and I, by the Spirit of the Lord, can stand and give testimony to what it means to be born again and made a new creation and be part of the family of God. That's a walk. That's a walk. Somebody said it's a hard time. It's a wicked generation. No, Enoch walked with God in much more wicked time than it is now. It's going to get worse. Listen to me, people. You want to have a popular message? We will be hated by everyone for his name's sake. And never in society has that been more developed. We've enjoyed in the Western world something that has not really been available to the church. For the majority of time over the past 2,000 years, we've had the privilege and the luxury of having government on the side of the message of Jesus Christ. That's changing. Get ready. Get ready. That's what Jesus said. You'll be hated of all nations. He also said, in Luke, he said, you'll be hated of all nations for my sake. And Matthew said, you'll be hated by everyone for my name's sake. But it's going to be glorious. For everyone who will walk with him, serve him. It's a wellspring springing up. It's a river flowing out. It's a joy unspeakable and full of glory. It's a peace that passes understanding. Hallelujah. It's a love that goes beyond all knowledge. There to be filled with the fullness of God no matter what you are in. Paul said, in all my tribulation, I'm exceedingly glad. In every affliction that comes at me, I rejoice. And again, I say rejoice, he says to the people at Thessalonica. Because there's something about trusting God, walking with him, that if we'll just stand fast in the liberty wherewith he has made us free, we're going to have nothing but the consequences of all that he said is ours. James was martyred. They couldn't kill John. They say they tried to boil him in oil, and he wouldn't boil. And I'm sure he wasn't scarred up either. They tried to exile him on Patmos, but he would not die. Huh? Philip was able to raise four daughters who prophesied, build what we believe to be a great church. But Stephen was stoned quickly for his testimony. Whichever. Come on, man. Walk with God. Come walk with God. It's provable. It's reproducible. Not one single word that he has spoken shall fail you. Thank you. Thank you, living God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Father, we thank you that you strengthen us by the Holy Spirit in our inner being so that we can lay hold on all the things that you've given to us. Today, I recognize that there's people standing in this place that you've never been introduced to Jesus, and we're introducing him to you right now. But God, the Holy Ghost wants to introduce him in a way that goes beyond what we can introduce him. All you have to do is call upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, and God said he will save you. And somebody says, what is he saving me from? The life that you've been living, the way that you've been living it. He's saving you from the claims of hell upon your soul, a tyranny that goes far beyond any tyranny upon the earth today. People say, well, what about ISIS? What about this? What about the demonic? There's no tyranny as that which Satan imposes upon those who have not been set free by Christ Jesus. God wants to save you today. He wants to deliver you today. But he wants you to come to him in such a way that you're done with your life. He didn't come to give you a promise of life while you remain unchanged. He's come to change your heart so that you want different kinds of things. You want the ways of God, not the ways of the demonic, not the ways of this world. If you're tired of sin, if you're tired of the way that you've been living your life, if you're tired of just a mere, purely human existence, which is worse than that when sin is imposed upon your life, then God is calling you. He says, come to me and I'll give you rest. Come, I'll free you, I'll set you free. I'll liberate you. I'll give you life and I'll give it to you more abundantly. If you call upon the name of Jesus right now, he has promised that he will respond to your call. But it has to be a call of sincerity. I've seen too many people call upon the name of Jesus and they were determined to live the same kind of life that they've been living. No, can't do that. He's calling you to leave everything that you know and that you're comfortable with to come and walk with him so he can show you how to really live. All you have to do is call upon the name of the Lord. You may not understand that. You may not even begin to be able to deal with that in any way. But you recognize that the way you've been living isn't the way that you want to continue on living. All you have to do is stop right where you're at right now. Call upon the name of the Lord Jesus. He'll come rescue you. And he'll show you. He'll put on the inside of you the willingness, the desire, and the excitement. Hallelujah. To do it his way instead of your way. You'll get to where you're at the crossroads of your way versus his way, and you're going to just automatically say, I don't understand it, but I know what your way, choosing your way always results in. Choosing your way always results in blessing. So I'm going to do it your way. If there's anybody in here today, you've not met Jesus, come meet him now. It's now. Call upon the name of the Lord. It's just that easy. God has made it that easy. You call upon the name of the Lord and he'll save you. You allow him to come by invitation of your own heart, and he will create a whole new realm of existence for you. He'll create a new heart, a new spirit. Anyone today, whether you're standing here in this place or you're watching me on the web or on YouTube, you want to know the living God. You want to know what it means to live forever. You want to know what it means to walk in the realms of power and divine authority. You want to understand that which framed the heavens and created the world. The Creator himself is calling you with an invitation written in his love and written in his own blood, saying, I give you everything that I have. This is his promise. God spared not his own son, but offered him up for the sins of us all. How much more shall he also by him freely give us everything? Hallelujah. You in sorrow? You want out? I got joy for you, says the Lord. You in condemnation and shame? The Lord says, I got peace for you. You walking in hate and offense and unforgiveness and rejection and hurt, God says, I have love for you. It's just that simple. Will you come right now? Anyone in this place, anyone watching by the web, on YouTube, come right now. Come to him. He's calling you. One more time, I'm just going to ask everybody in this place, I want you to do something with me that will cause you to experience the presence of God no matter who you are. I want you to lift your hands towards heaven, the Spirit, the presence of God. If there's sickness in your body and disease in your body, I command it to go right now in the name of Jesus Christ. If there's hurt and turmoil in your life, torment in your mind, goes from you now. Goes now in Jesus' name. I set you free. Now in Jesus' name, you get free from this day forward. I break the power of anxiety. I break the power of depression. That debilitating disease, fibromyalgia, that comes from depression and anxiety. I break the power of it now in Jesus' name. In the name of Jesus Christ, by the power that is in his name, the redeeming work of his blood, put it on you now, in Jesus' name. The name above every name. If you're willing to walk with God, he'll give you the authority. He'll give you divine ability to be sons of God, to believe upon his name. You'll begin to live out a life of signs and wonders that all the world about you desires to know and understand. I pray no matter who you are, how long you've walked with God, no matter if you don't know him at all or if you've known him for a long time, that today you'll take a hold of these things. If you've not known God, you'll come into his presence and be known by him. If you backslid, you'll return and come here. If you've been walking with God a long time, you'll be revived and come and take a hold of being a witness of this wonderful, abundant life. In the name of Jesus, I break the curse, I break the sorrow, I break the depression, I break the affliction, I break off the torment. I command in the name of Jesus for the wellspring to spring. I command in the name of Jesus. That's all right, just leave her. I command in the name of Jesus for the rivers of God to flow. In the name of Jesus, that's all right, just leave her. That's all right, just leave her. I said, that's all right, just leave her. Hello, I said, that's all right, just leave her. I said, that's all right, just leave her, let God touch her. People, respond to God, listen. Listen to what the Lord says. We can't touch what God is doing. Don't touch what God is doing. He wants to use you, and that's wonderful, but leave what God is doing alone. He doesn't really need our help, just our cooperation. That's all. He can do this on his own. We just get to proclaim his word and move and flow in his anointing. In Jesus' name, wisdom comes to your life. In Jesus' name, understanding comes to your life. In Jesus' name, so that you can function in the Spirit of the Lord and walk with God. Hallelujah. The healing power of God flows right here in this place. Right now, for everybody, I don't care who you are. You may have rejected Jesus. I tell you, his healing flow will come to your body right now. Whatever you have need of, I tell you, God, it's not magic. It's love. It's his power. It's his grace. It's his living presence. He'll heal you now. He'll provide for you now. His love is extended to all men, everywhere. Just receive. Just receive. Just receive. Just receive. Hallelujah. Just receive. Right now, just receive. Receive joy. It's a wellspring. Receive peace right now. Receive love right now. Receive encouragement right now. God's giving you a measure of faith and he'll increase it. Hallelujah. Right now. Receive right now. The operation of the power of God in your life. Receive right now. Right now. Every harassing, tormenting power of darkness that would try to oppose you, I command in the name of Jesus Christ to back off. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, the positivity. If there's anyone here today, right now, you have sickness or disease in your body, torment in your body, in your mind, affliction. You want us to pray with you and for you, we'll pray with you and for you. Once again, If you don't know that you're right with God, maybe you believe that you are. Maybe you were baptized as a child, but you're not sure where you stand with God. You've had all these religious ideas and all these religious notions, but you're not sure where you stand with God. God wants to make you certain today. He wants to give you boldness and confidence in Him today. He wants you to understand who you are in Him and who He is in you. No matter what your situation, physical or spiritual, God is calling you. He wants to touch you right now. Anyone in this place, anyone. Let me just tell you, His love and His goodness and His provision is always available to you. Always. It just right now in the midst of His church is just that much more effective. Jesus. Hallelujah. Oh, how I love you, Jesus. Oh, how I love you, Lord, because you first loved me. God, He is so good. He's so good. He's so good. Spirit of the Lord is touching so many different people right now. Changing people's lives, changing people's situations, changing people's physical bodies, changing people's ability to walk with Him, to trust Him, to believe Him, to move out into the realms of faith, even though it opposes and defies logic. Hallelujah. He breaks the power of cancer in the spirit of it. Breaks the power and the affliction of every central nervous system disease in the spirit of it. Every mental disease in the spirit of it. He breaks a love for the world in the spirit of it. He breaks the power of temptation that has been able to make you bow your knees to it in the spirit of it. He teaches us to love righteousness and hate iniquity. What a great God. He redeems us and shows us how to walk in His redemption. He fills us with His love and teaches us how to love it. Amen. Amen, amen, amen. I agree with you, Lord. We agree with you. The healing waters are here. Just step in. All the way to the back. Just step in. Healing waters here. Just step in. Step in. Somebody said, how do I step in? You just begin to yield yourself to Him. Just begin to worship Him. Begin to praise Him. Begin to thank Him for it. Thank you. Going to give all of you an opportunity to come worship the Lord with your tithes and your offerings. Worship is a beautiful, wonderful thing. Worship always results in a manifest presence of God's glory as long as we do it right. We do it in faith. Always. Worship is something so glorious. Is that right? Just stay right. You're fine. You're fine. Worship is always something so glorious. Worship's always something so glorious. God takes a little obedience, just a little bit of obedience. God takes just a little bit of obedience and creates the greatest miracles of faith. And when you worship the Lord with your heart, believe that's what's going on. When you obey God's word, believe that's what's going on. When you worship the Lord with your finances, you believe that's what's going on. You believe that's what's going on. That the smallest acts of obedience creates the greatest miracles of faith. Lord, I don't know how I'm going to do this. I don't know how this is going to work out. I don't understand it with my thinking, but I'm going to step out that direction in obedience to you. God shows up with the greatest miracles of faith. Hallelujah. Doesn't He? Yes.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. So many times we've been in situations where people said they were going to kill us. In third world countries, you're going to be killed. Everybody's going to be with you. It's going to be killed. Threatening situations, so many different situations. And every time we counted not our lives dear unto ourselves, but to simply obey God and do what He said. And the greatest, you know, the one I've discovered, the louder that devil barks, the louder his threats, the more scared he is. Huh? Come on. Just go ahead and say, listen, whether I live or whether I die, hear, O King, whether we live or whether we die, we will not bow to your word nor worship your idols that you've made. We're going to obey God. Every time, Father works a miracle, signs and wonders and miracles. Somebody said, your luck may run out. I said, my blessing will never cease. It will never, because if I leave this life, I step over into the next one. Besides that, I mean, come on. Crown him with many crowns. People, the Lord has so much to give to us. He has so much he wants to supply through our lives. Just go ahead and live your life big for him, because he wants to live big through you. Hallelujah. God, the Holy Spirit, will live big through your life. God, the Holy Ghost, will live big through your life. In the name of Jesus, you walk in healing, you walk in this blessing, and you walk in divine authority from this day forward. In Jesus' name, those things that harassed you and tormented you will harass you and torment you no more. But the wellspring of life will flow forth from your life and your being. You come to understand how to live out joy and rejoicing and praise and thanksgiving. I speak to your body in the name of Jesus Christ, to your mind, to your spirit. Be healed. Filled up with the goodness of heaven. Gladness of heart. Joy and rejoicing. In Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, mighty God. It's Jesus. Menashe. Hallelujah. Karasa Deyavai. This is case to the name of it. My name is it. And it shall never cease. Shall never cease. Amen. Find a bunch of people around you, hug them, tell them that you love them, and bless them in Jesus' name. In numero de Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Ginila con Spirito Santo. Ginila con goza. Hallelujah.